Hello and welcome students, myself Piraj Majumdar and I welcome you to my official YouTube channel Make Pro Classes. And we are continuing our manufacturing processes, that is the module 2. Here we have completed introduction to bulk metal and sheet metal forming processes. We have discussed thoroughly plastic deformation and yield criteria. We have also discussed about fundamentals of hot and cold working processes. We have also completed extrusion drawing process in bulk metal forming process, and we have also covered different sheet metal forming operations such as shearing, deep drawing, bending and spinning and many others. And today we are going to have some discussion on forging, which is also one of the most widely used bulk metal forming process. And in the next class we will be having discussion on principles of powder metallurgy. So let us start today's class. So we will be having some discussions on the forging process, which is also a widely used bulk metal forming process. Look, the forging it is a very common process. Generally in we used to say the kamarsala shop. In kamarsala shop, this particular forging operation is being performed. You might have seen around in your neighborhood or your vicinity of your neighborhood, there are some shops where people are hammering a particular red hot material to give it a desired shape. Okay, so that is the smithy and forging shop. Okay, so forging is the operation where the metal is heated and then a force is applied to manipulate the metal in such a way that the required final shape is obtained. As I was saying, so you have to first red hot. Generally it is a hot working process. Okay, so you have to first apply heat and then you have to hammer it, or you have to apply force to give the required final shape. Now this is one of the oldest of the metal working processes known to mankind since the copper age. And forging, as I earlier told you, is generally a hot working process, but sometimes cold forging is also used. Okay, so here you will find that it is a process working, it is a metal working process by which metals or alloys are plastically deformed to the desired shapes by a compressive force applied with the help of pair of dies. Now, because of the manipulative ability of the forging process, it is possible to closely control the grain flow in the specific direction such that the best mechanical properties can be obtained based on the specific application. Okay. Now, this is a diagram. Here you will find the metal flow in a particular forging operation. Okay, now before I go directly, I just want to share some typical commonly used or performed forging operations. First one I'll write for you, that will be your drawing. This is also known as drawing operation, but it is somewhat different from the previous one we have learned in the sheet metal, where drawing was actually, it was somewhat different, this drawing operation. What is this? Actually it is drawing out. Okay, so drawing out should be the actual term for forging. And next one is your upsetting. These two are very commonly performed forging operation. So you must keep in mind that drawing out and upsetting are two most commonly used forging operations. So let us see what is drawing out. Look, drawing out is an operation in which the metal gets elongated with a reduction in the cross-sectional area. So say we have a metal such like that, and you are actually this one, okay, not this one, this is a different. So let me draw another picture. So what happens, say this is the material and you are applying say force over here, and the cross section being, the cross section is somewhat reduced, say this one. Okay, so cross section is reduced, but it is elongated. The material is elongated. So you can find, this is the drawing, first operation. This is a drawing out. So metals get elongated with a reduction. You can see the reduction in the cross sectional area. Okay, and for this purpose, force is to be applied in a direction perpendicular to the axis, length axis, or you can say this is the length axis. Okay, so this is the length axis. So force is applied perpendicular to the length axis. So this is the drawing out operation. Next operation is your upsetting operation. Now here what happens, so this is the material and you are applying along the length, this is the axis of the length. So along the length you are applying the force. What happens, the length becomes reduced, but the cross section area get enlarged. You can see over here. So this is the second operation and it is known as upsetting. So these two are very important forging operations being widely used. Okay, so once again I am just repeating, this is applied to increase the cross sectional area of the stock at the expense of its length. To achieve the upsetting, force is applied in a direction, as you can see over here, this one is applied parallel to the length axis. Previously in the drawing out operation, the force was acting perpendicular to the length axis, or axis of the length you can say. Now because of the manipulative ability of the forging process, it is possible to closely control the this grain structure you can see over here, the grain structure. Okay, now so it is very much possible to control the grain flow in the specific direction such that the best mechanical properties can be obtained. As you can see over here, the flow, grain flow directions obtained in forging, as you can see over here. So now these are some examples, and say this is a crane hook. Okay, so say this is a crane hook, and it is possible to get the two types of grain patterns by the proper arrangement of operations. Okay, so in the first you can see this one, the grain pattern obtained without bending is shown over here, this one without bending. Okay, whereas the one in this one is obtained by bending after drawing out. What is the drawing out? When the metal gets elongated with a reduction in the cross-sectional area. So cross-sectional area will be reduced and it will elongate. That is the drawing out operation. So you can see from this particular. Okay, so what happens as a result, the grain flow is also bent along the hook, as you can see over here, this one, the grain is bent, grain flow is also bent along the hook, and thus provide the necessary strength for lifting the load. So usually this heavy load lifting devices are generally forced so that grain flow take in the direction of the forging, which is gives sound mechanical properties for lifting loads. And for this one you can see over here, it is also similarly the gear blank, as you can see over here, is obtained by upsetting the blank and then finish forging. Whereas actually this one, in this one what happens, it is obtained by upsetting the blank only. Okay, the upsetting process provides the radial grain flow, which is essential for good strength in gear tip for severe applications. Now there are different types of these forging operations being performed so you can see over here there are different operations like open and closed die forging. So there are many types. I can write it some of them for you. There are many forging types, so I can write it for you. Say Smith forging, next is your drop forging, press forging, machine forging is also there. So these are the common types of forging process. So Smith forging is a traditional forging operation done openly in or in open dies by the village blacksmith, or modern shop floor by manual hammering or by power hammers. And for drop forging, we are having a closed impression dies by means of drop hammers. Here the force for shaping the component is applied in a series of blows. In press forging, it is also similar to drop forging. It is also done in closed impression dies, with the exception that the force is a continuous squeezing type applied by the hydraulic process presses actually. And in machine forging, unlike the this drop or press forging where the material is drawn out, in machine forging the material is only upset to get a desired shape. So talking about the particular smith forging, I have got a picture to show you. So say this one is a smith forging. So you can see over here, we are having a top fuller. This is the work, and this is the anvil. You can see over here, this is the bottom fuller. So actually what happens, it involves hitting the stock in blacksmith's hearth and then hitting it over the anvil, this one. To get the desired shape, the operator has to manipulate the component in between the blows, this one. The types of operations available for this type, fullering. There are fullering, flattening, bending, upsetting and swaging also, okay. So they are also very important. In fullering, what happens, the material cross section is decreased and length is increased, like the, this drawing out operation, okay. So fullering, you can also remember by drawing out, it is also similar to drawing out. And for performing this particular fullering operation, you have to, the bottom fuller is kept in the anvil hole, okay. And with the heated stock over the fuller, the top fuller is then kept above the stock, and then with the sledgehammer, the force is to be applied to this particular top fuller, okay. The fullers concentrate the force over a very small area, thus decreasing the cross section at that particular point. As you can see over here, the cross section are being decreased, okay. And metal flows outward and away from the center of the fullering die. Then the stock is advanced slightly, this one is advanced slightly over the fuller, and the process is repeated. As you can see over here, it becomes doing this one, okay. So it is advanced. After fullering, the stock would have the fullering marks left, which are then cleansed by means of flattening. And to obtain specific shapes such as round, square, hexagon, etc., open general purpose die called swages. Swage block I have already shown you in my previous lecture. Swage block is also there, unlike this anvil. So to obtain this hexagon, round or square section, you have to take the help of swage block, okay. Now the force for shaping is applied by manual hammering or by means of forging hammers, generally used in our industrial purpose and workshops also, okay. Now smith forging also involves a lot of skill on the part of the operator and also is more time consuming. But since no special dies are used, smith forging is more beneficial in the manufacture of small parts or in trial production, because the heavy cost of the closed impression dies cannot be justified in this particular cases, okay. Now let us have some knowledge of this particular open and closed die forging. So depending upon complexity of the part, as you can see over here, forging is carried out as open die forging and closed die forging, okay. Now in open die forging, the metal is compressed by repeated blows by a mechanical hammer and shape is manipulated manually. And in closed die forging, the desired configuration is obtained by squeezing the workpiece between two shape and closed dies. Now here you can see a diagram of barreling. As you can see, it is somewhat like the upsetting process. As you can see over here, force is being applied along the length of the axis, and it is the this length is being reduced and the cross sectional area is being increased, okay. So frictional forces are acting at this interfaces of these dies, you can see over here. So inhomogeneous deformation with barreling of the workpiece. Now here you can see the open die forging as well as closed die forging. So here is an example of closed die forging. As you can see, the die being is used to cover the total this workpiece. In this picture it is very clear. So upper die and lower die is being used to close the particular this workpiece. So this is known as closed die forging. And in this particular open die forging, as you can see over here. This is not closed, you can see from outside while performing the operation. So this is actually large turbine shaft. For large turbine shaft, they are doing this open die forging operation. Next, spin forging, as I earlier told you, this is a very common process used in our blacksmiths. So blacksmiths uses this forging method, and quality of the product depends on the skill of the operator, not used in industry. It is commonly used for producing a small type of, you know, products. Okay, now coming to the advantages of forging, discrete shape of product can be produced. As you can see, we have got this switch blocks and wheel, so we can produce discrete shape of product. Mechanical properties and reliability of the materials increases due to improve in crystal structure. And in forging, favorable grain orientation of metal is obtained that strengthen the component, but forging distorts the previously created unidirectional fiber. So as I already discussed with you, the after the forging operation, the metal flow takes place in the direction of the hammering or force applied along the, you know, this bending of the particular pin hook, as I previously show you in this particular picture. So what happens, favorable grain orientation of the metal is obtained that strengthen the component, but forging distorts the previously created unidirectional fiber. Okay, now again, forging reduces the grain size of the metal, okay, which increases strength. Again, forging helps in increasing strength and toughness, that you must take a note as you are going to have this, you know, this type of MCQs, that forging actually helps increases strength and toughness. That is very important. Also, as a side effect, fatigue and creep strength increases. So these two are very important, you must take a note somewhere. Forging increases strength and toughness, but as a side effect, fatigue and creep strength also increases. So you have got double benefit out of this forging operation. Okay, so with this forging you are getting a very durable material. As you can see over here, we are having this fatigue and creep strength increased, and also strength and toughness increased. Next, we are having disadvantages of the forging operation. Now look, it is a somewhat costly operation, and dimensional accuracy and surface finish are not up to that mark, and it is also limited to simple steps and has limitations for parts having undercuts or reentrant surfaces as well. Now, forgeability. So forgeability of a metal can be defined as its capability to undergo deformation by forging without cracking. So that is the forgeability. Okay, so up to what extent you can forge a particular material without being cracked, that is the ability of a particular metal. Now, metal which can be formed easily without cracking with low force has good forgeability. Upsetting test, hot twist test are used to determine forgeability. Forgeability increases with temperature. Now, draft. Draft is very important. As you can see from very beginning of this particular module, draft are being used at different times in pattern analysis as well, and many other processes we are using drafting, blanking, piercing, punching operations, we are also using drafting. So you already know draft is the angular, you know, clearance. So you can see over here the draft word on the sides for withdrawal, easy withdrawal of, you know, forging. So adequate draft should be provided at least 3 degrees for aluminium and 5 to 7 degrees for steel. Internal surfaces require more draft than external surfaces for, you know, easy removal. And during cooling, what happens, forging tends to shrink towards its center, and as a result, the external surfaces are likely to be separated, whereas the internal surfaces tend to cling to the die more strong. Now, flash. What is flash? The excess metal added to the stock. So here you can see this is a flash. To ensure complete filling of the die cavity in the finishing impression is called slab. So you can see over here, this is the component, and this is the extra thing, extra material. You can see over here, this is the width, as you can see over here, and this is the flash, the, you know, extra metal added to ensure complete filling of the die cavity. Okay, so this is the flash. Next, flash acts as a cushion for impact blows, from the finishing impression and also helps to restrict the outward flow of metal, thus helping in filling of thin ribs and bosses in the upper die. The amount of flash depends on the forging size and may vary from 10% to 50%. The forging load can be decreased by increasing the flash thickness. Now, gutter. So, gutter is, you know, an addition to the flash. Provision should be made in the die for additional space so that any excess metal can flow and help in the complete closing of the die. This is called as gutter. So, enclosed. So, you can see from this particular diagram, in closed die forging, what happens? The upper and lower die completely closes the workpiece in between it itself. So, this is a flash line as you can see, and this is the gutter. So, this is the depth and this is the width you can see over here. So, gutter is provided so that extra material can, any excess material can flow and help in complete closing of the die. So, without a gutter, a flash may become excessively thick, not allowing the dies to close completely. Gutter depth and width should be sufficient to accommodate the extra material. Now, this is very important. So, you must take a note. This is sequential steps in closed die forging. First is your fullering or swaging, that is reducing cross-sectional and making it longer. Next, your edging or rolling, it is used to perform shape or give shape, gathers the materials as required in the final forging. Next is your bending operation, where it is required for those parts which have a bend shape. Next is your drawing or cogging, like fullering, but cross-section of only one end is reduced. Next is your flattening, where you have to flatten the stroke so that it fits properly into the finishing impression. Next is your flattening. It is blocking. So, semi-finishing operation, it imparts to the forging its general but not exact or final shape. Next is your finishing, final impression, flash line and gutter provided to the die. And last is your trimming or cut off, that is the removal of flash present around forging. So, these are the steps involved in closed die forging. Next, drop forging consists of two halves. The lower half of the die is fixed to the anvil of the machine. As you can see over here in the previous picture, I have already shown you in the smithy forging, while the upper half is fixed to the ram. The heated stock is kept in the lower die, while the ram delivers 4 to 5 blows on the metal in quick succession so that the metal spreads and completely fills the cavity. When the two halves close, the cavity, complete cavity is formed. And dove forging, it is very important, is used to produce small components. Next is your machine forging. Unlike the drop or press forging, where the material is drawn out, in machine forging, the material is only upset to get the desired shape. Next is your upset. I already discussed with you, it is increasing the diameter of a material by compressing its length. And drawing is just completely opposite of this upset. And you know, it employs split dies that contain multiple positions or cavities. Next is your roll forging. When the rolls are in the open position, the heated stroke is advanced up to the stock. As the rolls rotate, the grip and roll down the stock. The stock is transferred to a second set of groups, the rolls turn again and so on until the piece is finished. So you can see over there, roll forging is over here. As you can see, this is the die over here, this is the stop, and this is the shaft you can see over here, and this is the back rest, this is the front rest, this is the tongue. So, as you can see over here, the cross sectional view, as you can see over here, is a very rapid process. So, here you will find when the rolls are in the open position, the heated stock is advanced up to the stop. As the rolls rotate, they grip and roll down the stock. The stock is transferred to a second set of groups. The rolls run again and so on until the piece is finished. So, here you can correlate. So, this one is a heated, you know, this is a heated metal bar. It is being pushed up to this particular stop. Then, this, you know, the rotating dies are being employed to give it a shape. Okay. Now, skew rolling, as you can see over here. Skew rolling produces metal balls. So, you can see over here, this is the metal balls are coming out of this particular stock, round stock. Round stock is fed continuously to two specially designed opposing rolls. Okay, this one is opposing rolls, these are. So, where from you can get a rotating, this is actually circular balls, okay, metal balls. Okay. So, metal is forged by each of the groups in the rolls and emerges from the end as a metal ball. So, that is very important.
you should take a note, that is Q rolling is used to produce metal balls. Next is your lubrication for forging. Lubrications influence friction, wear, deforming forces and flow of material and die cavities, non-sticking thermal barrier also. For hot forging, we are using graphite MOS2 and sometimes molten glass. For cold forging, mineral oils and soaps. In hot forging, lubricant is applied to the dies, but in cold forging, it is actually placed on the workpiece. Okay. Now, coming to the some of the forging defects, it is unfilled section. First is your unfilled section. Die cavity is not completely filled due to improper design of die. Now, this is cold shut. You have already heard this particular cold shutting defects of casting also. So, cold shut is a small crack at the corners and at right angles to the forged surface. Okay, and it is caused due to improper design of die. So, it is also very important, improper design of die, we are having cold shut. Next is our scale pits. It is irregular depressions on the surface due to improper cleaning of the stock. Next is die shift due to misalignment of the two hubs or making the two hubs of the forging to be improper set. And next is your flex. There is an internal ruptures caused by the improper cooling. Next is your improper grain flow. This is caused by the improper design of the die, which makes the flow of metal not flowing the final intended directions. Next is your forging laps. These are the folds of metal squeezed together during forging. They have irregular contours and occur at right angles to the direction of metal flow. And in hot tears and thermal cracking, these are surface cracks occurring due to non-uniform cooling from the forging stage or during heat treatment. Now, one more thing I would like to share with you, die materials. What are the characteristics of a particular ideal die materials? You can say it should have good hardness, toughness and ductility at low and elevated temperatures. It should have adequate fatigue resistance. It should have sufficient hardenability. It should have low thermal conductivity. It should have amenability to weld repair. It should have good machinability. And generally the die materials are of chromium, molybdenum, vanadium alloy tool steel, or chromium, nickel, molybdenum alloy tool steel also. So today we have discussed the forging process. Hope you have enjoyed the today's class. And if you have any query, you can comment in the comment section. Thank you for watching.